So in the last unit, that means in unit 3, we have discussed about the single stage small signal amplifier. More specifically, we have discussed about the three different configurations: common emitter configuration, common base configuration, and common collector configuration. And we have also seen the relative advantages and disadvantages of each of these different configurations. And we have calculated the expression for voltage gain, the expression for current gain, the expression for input impedance, and the expression for the output impedance for each of these configurations. Eventually, we have only considered the small signal amplifier with a single stage. That means if I want to observe the amplifier as a black box, normally we do. We observe the amplifier as a black box like this, because we are representing the amplifier as a two-port network. And so far, we have considered only one such black box for our analysis. Now, whenever we are connecting two such black box in cascade, two or more than two, then it is known as a multi-stage kind of thing. So for the simplicity of our analysis or discussion, let us start with two such amplifiers in cascade so as to have the essence of a multi-stage amplifier. So here, this particular amplifier is having its input port like this. Now the output port of the first stage is connected to the input port of the second stage. And the output of the second stage is considered to be the final output. So for simplicity, here we have considered only two such amplifiers. But frankly speaking, we can have more than two stages in cascade so as to have a multi-stage amplifier. Now this is the amplifier one, first amplifier, with a voltage gain, say, AV1. And this is a second amplifier with a voltage gain, say, AV2. Now let us assume that the input signal which we apply over here, the small signal applied over here, is, let it be Vin. Now this will be multiplied by the gain factor, and as far as we consider that the gain is constant, that means we are in the midband range of the amplifier, then I can think that the output which has been developed over here is given by, let it be V out one. Let it be V out one. Then I can write V out one, the open circuit voltage available over here. Whenever there is no such second stage connected, this is given by, as you understand, AV1 times Vin. Because AV1 is the gain of the first stage and Vin is the input to the amplifier, so as a matter of fact, the output available over here, output available over here is given by Vout1, that is AV1 times Vin. Now, while calculating this V out one, we have considered that there is no such second stage connected over here. Now, whenever a second stage amplifier having a voltage gain of AV2 is connected at the output of the first stage, now the second stage will load the output of the first stage. And as a matter of fact, the output signal, which is getting coupled at the input of the second stage over here, is not equal to AV1 times Vin. Now we will discuss this one in much more detail. Now let us consider that the input signal which has been developed over here is given by Vin2. Now let it be Vin2. As soon as we connect the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage, then the output of the first stage, that means V out one, is equal to V in two. That is quite obvious. But V out one expression will no longer be AV1 times V in. This V out one is equal to AV1 times V in is only true whenever the second stage is absent. But as far as our convention is concerned, if I consider that v out 1 is the output of the first stage and v in 2 is the input of the second stage, then I can always write that v out 1 is equal to v in 2. Now, the output of the second stage is given by v out 2. Now, as soon as we connect the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage, I can't write V out 1 is equal to simply AV1 times V in. Why not? Because I have to observe the internal architecture of the amplifier itself so as to have a discrete expression for the output waveform available over here. Now, let us try to understand what is there inside this amplifier. Now we know that if I just draw the output side of this amplifier, we know that we can have a circuit like this, the output end. Either I can have a voltage source in series with a resistance, output resistance, or I can have a current source in shunt with a output resistance. So I can have two defined models. Either I write GM times VPI, the current source, and R0 in shunt, or I can also write AV1 times V in and the resistance in series with that. So this is basically AV1 times V in, which is nothing but the open circuit AV1 times V in, open circuit voltage, which is available over here. Now, if I do not connect anything between these two points, so this is the output port of the first stage of amplification. Between these two points, if I do not connect anything and if I measure the voltage over here, so this is nothing but the open circuit voltage, and that voltage must be equal to AV1 times Vin. That is quite obvious. Now, as soon as I make this connection, the output of the first stage, whenever it is connected to the input of the second stage, then this input of the second stage will load this particular output. And this loading is taking place in the form of the input impedance or input resistance of the second stage amplifier. Suppose the input impedance over here is given by R in 2. So this V out 1 is given by, so if this is R out 1, if this is the output resistance of the first stage, then this V out 1 is given by AV1 times V in multiplied with R in 2 upon R out 1 plus R in 2. So this is the expression which connects V out 1 with V in 1. It is not as simple as V out 1 is equal to AV1 times V in. Because while I write this equation, V out 1 is equal to AV1 times V in, then I make the mistake that I have not considered the corresponding input and output resistances of the two stages respectively. So V out 1 is given by AV1 times V in into R in 2 by R out 1 plus R in 2 when the input of the first second stage is connected to the output of the first stage. However, V out 1 is equal to AV1 times V in. This is nothing but the open circuit voltage. Whenever the second stage is not connected over here, if I want to measure only the open circuit voltage, that means there is no current through this output resistance, then obviously the open circuit voltage is given by AV1 times V in. Now this is equal to V in 2. Similarly, I can write down the expression for V out 2. In the same manner, this V out 2 is given by AV2 times V into multiplied with, if I have a load resistance over here connected between the output ports with a value equal to RL, for example, then I can write this is equal to RL upon RL plus R out 2. So this is the expression which relates V out 2 with V in 2. Similarly, here also you can have a voltage source. You can have a voltage source of magnitude AV2 times V in 2 and the output resistance in series with that. So you can have any of the two models, either voltage source in series with the resistance, output resistance, or current source in shunt with the output resistance. So these two models are eventually identical. Any one of these two models you can consider for your calculation. Now, coming back to this, or I can also write V in 1, this one is V in 1, because it is the input that is applicable at the input port of the first stage. Now, whenever there is a signal source connected at this point, we need to find out the amount of the signal source which is actually getting coupled to the input of the first stage of the amplification. So basically, we have a signal source like this with a source resistance, a non-zero source resistance. Suppose this is Vs, and we have a source resistance Rs over here. This is connected to the first stage of the amplifier. Now, if the source resistance is zero, so in that case, there will be no coupling loss, and the entire input signal will be coupled to the input side of the first stage. But in case we have a non-zero source resistance, so in which case you have to include this R in 1, which is nothing but the input resistance of the first stage, and we can relate V in 1 as Vs multiplied with R in 1 divided by Rs plus R in 1. So this factor is also there. So eventually we want that this factor must be close to 1, but as long as non-zero Rs is there, so this R in 1 can, this R in 1 upon Rs plus R in 1 cannot be 1, but it will be less than 1. So ultimately, in order to find out the overall voltage gain, AV overall, which is nothing but the ratio between V out 2 upon Vs. Vs is the signal that is applied over here, the small signal which you want to amplify. And V out 2 is the output voltage available at the output of this multi-stage amplifier. So here we have considered only two stages. So this will be the output available at the second stage amplifier, at the output of the second stage amplifier. So this is given by V out 2 upon Vs. So if I just substitute all this expression, then you will find that this expression, AV overall, turns out to be AV1 times AV2 times, we have three different coupling losses. First one is R in 1 upon Rs plus R in 1. This is the coupling loss which is taking place while we feed the input signal to the input of the first stage. Then comes the second coupling loss, which is equal to R in 2 upon R out 1 plus R in 2. Which is due to the fact that we connect the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage. And finally, this one, RL upon RL plus R out 2. This is due to connecting the output of the second stage to some externally connected load resistance. So eventually, whenever a very popular question normally arises, that we have a small signal amplifier, two stages of small signal amplifier, having a voltage gain of say 100 and 100. So that means AV1 is equal to 100 and AV2 is equal to 100. Now you have an input signal over here with a peak-to-peak variation of 5 millivolt. Then what would be the output signal available over here? Whether it would be like 5 into 10 to the power 4 or less than 5 into 10 to the power 4 or greater than 5 into 10 to the power 4. So there could have been three different options. So our intention says that normally we say that, okay, this particular amplifier is having a voltage gain of 100. This particular amplifier is having a voltage gain of 100. So since they are connected in cascade, so obviously the overall voltage gain will be like 10 to the power 4, because 100 into 100 will give us 10 to the power 4. So normally we forget to include this coupling losses. There are different coupling losses. One is because of the coupling of the input signal, input signal Vs to the first stage of the amplifier. Second one is the coupling of the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage. And finally, the output of the second stage is connected to the load. So there are three stages of coupling. And as a matter of fact, the overall voltage gain will be severely less as compared to the product of the individual gain of the amplifiers. Now, our objective is to reduce the gain factor, is to increase the gain factor and to reduce these coupling losses as much as possible. So for a typical design of amplifier, we always want that this Rin1 should be very, very large as compared to Rs. And similarly, we must want that input resistance of an amplifier should be high with respect to Rout1, that means the output resistance, and RL, the load resistance of the amplifier, should be high with respect to the output resistance of the second stage. So if I follow this, or if these conditions are satisfied, then you'll see that, or I should use the term very, very greater than, so that this ratio will be close to one. So under this condition, you'll see that these three coupling losses will be close to one. Eventually, it will be always less than one, but if I make this assumption, then it will be close to one. Then instead of having 10 to the power 4 as overall voltage gain, you can have like 0.95 into 10 to the power 4 or 0.96 into 10 to the power 4. So that you can achieve the overall voltage gain close to AV1 times AV2. But frankly speaking, for any practical amplifier, whenever there are multi-stage kind of thing, then obviously the overall voltage gain is less as compared to the product of the two different amplifiers. Now, let us consider analyzing this one. Let us start with a simple circuit like this. Simple fixed pass circuit. You can readily calculate the voltage gain. So we connect the signal source between these two points. This is the ground terminal. This is the VCC supply, DC power supply. There is some RB, there's some RC. And we have emitter resistance. And suppose it is bypassed by means of a capacitor, which is known as a bypass capacitor, which is CE. So this is the output voltage, VO. Now, you know, since already it has been discussed in our previous lectures that since this resistance, emitter resistance, is bypassed by means of this bypass capacitor, so eventually the voltage gain of this particular amplifier is governed, it's pretty much close to, if I just consider the magnitude of them, of the gain, it is close to GM times RC. And this is nothing but, if I just put the value of GM, this is nothing but IC upon VT. So this is nothing but ICRC upon VT. This is ICRC upon VT. Now what is that ICRC? So if I assume that we have a 12 volt supply over here, and let the RC, the collector resistance over here is 3 kilo ohms, and we are establishing a 2 milliampere collector current, DC collector current over here. ICQ or IC is equal to 2 milliampere. So under DC condition, suppose a 2 milliampere collector current is flowing through the resistance RC, and as a matter of fact, this VO is having a potential of 6 volt under DC condition, and over and above which there will be AC excursion whenever the small signal is applied between these two points. So we have a method to calculate the approximate value of the voltage gain, which is nothing but the DC drop across this resistance, ICRC drop, upon VT. So VT at room temperature, it is close to 25.5 millivolts. So for practical calculation, we can assume that this value is close to 25 millivolt. That means 25 and 10 to the power minus 3. So it is coming like 40. 1 upon VT is equal to 40 at room temperature. So this ICRC drops. So since it is 3 kilo ohms multiplied with 2 milliampere, so it will be having like a 3 into 2, that is 6, kilo into milli, that is, it will be same. So 3 into 2, that will be 6. So 6 multiplied with 40. So eventually, this gain is given by 240. So it's an easiest way to calculate the voltage gain by means of this, which is equal to 240. That is fine. Now suppose I connect this one, this first stage, at the input to the second stage. Suppose I connect this one, output of the first stage, at the input of the second stage. So this is the output. This is connected through a coupling capacitor to the second stage of the amplifier. So there is a same DC supply line I'm using. Suppose the value of RC is also same, 3 kilo ohms, for example. Now suppose there is no bypass capacitor over here. There is no bypass capacitor over here, and I'm assuming an emitter resistance value of say 100 ohms, for example. RD 100 ohms. And we would like to find out the V. Suppose this is, let it be, this is VO1 and this is VO2. So VO2 is the final output voltage available over here. Now this is the base resistance RB, for example. This is VCC supply. So as you understand, the output of the first stage, which is available over here, this output is connected through a capacitor. Obviously the capacitor will be there because we have planned to provide the DC biasing separately. So that's why these two stages, this is the first stage of amplification, this is the second stage of amplification. In the first stage, we don't have the provision of emitter resistance during the AC analysis. So that's why this is bypassed through this bypass capacitor CE. Whereas in the second stage, intentionally, we have included the emitter resistance, which will also be there during the AC analysis as well as during the DC analysis. Now these two stages are DC wise, they are separate by virtue of this coupling capacitor. So this coupling capacitor will isolate the DC operating point in the first stage of amplification with the DC operating point in the second stage of the amplification. So this coupling capacitor is performing the role of DC isolation over here between the two stages. This is CC or CC2. Now, as you understand, the output resistance of the first stage is essentially governed by this RC. Eventually, if you draw the small signal model of this particular amplification stage, the first stage of amplification, you'll see that there will be RC in shunt with R0. So these two resistances will be there in the output side of the amplifier. and the output resistance will be nothing but RC parallel R naught. But since R naught is very, very large with respect to RC, collector resistance, so therefore the output resistance of this amplifier is essentially governed by the collector resistance. So I can safely assume that R out 1 is equal to 3 kilo ohms, which is nothing but RC. R out 1 is equal to 3 kilo ohms, that is RC. Now, coming back to the input of this stage, or input resistance of this stage, as you know, we don't have this bypass capacitor over here, and moreover, this emitter is not directly connected to ground. It is connected to ground through a resistance RE. So, considering this particular topology, if we just follow the method to calculate the input resistance of the first stage, you know that input resistance of the first stage is essentially governed by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So there will be an enhancement of the input impedance by a factor of 1 plus beta because of the presence of this emitter resistance over here. And so R pi, so how to calculate R pi? You know how to calculate R pi. So R pi is given by VT upon IBQ. VT upon IBQ. Now, if I assume that these two stages are identical, so if I have a 2 milliampere of collector current over here, we have already considered IC is equal to 2 milliampere for the first stage. And if I assume that an identical stages or identical stages of biasing, and with a beta value equal to say, 100, or let it be 200, beta is equal to 200 for each of these two stages, then this VT, this thermal voltage, as you know, it will be like 25 millivolt at room temperature approximately. And IBQ, IBQ is nothing but ICQ upon beta. So it is 2 milliampere by 200. So it will be like 0.001. That means 1 microampere. So IBQ is given by 2 milliampere upon 200. That is, you have 2000 micro upon 200. No, it will be 10 microampere. So 10 microampere. IBQ will be 10 microampere. So if I put over here 10 microampere, if I put the value, so it will be coming like 2.5 kilo ohms. So R pi is coming like 2.5 kilo ohms. So as you know, this R pi, the input resistance, is normally in the order of few kilo ohms. So that is fine. It is coming like 2.5 kilo ohms over here. Now, what will be the value of RE in one? As RE is there, non-zero RE is there with a gain with a value of 100 ohms over here. So if I just put this value, so R pi is like 2.5. And 1 plus beta, I can roughly write this one like beta only. So beta times RE. So 200 into 100 ohms. So it will be 20 kilo ohms. 200 into 100, that is 20000, that is 20 kilo ohms. So 20 plus 2.5 kilo ohms. So it will be like 22.5 kilo ohms. So now you try to understand what will be the coupling loss. The coupling loss, whenever you are just measuring the output voltage over here at this particular point, without this stage connected, without the second stage connected, this output voltage will be as high as 240 times input voltage because the gain is equal to 240. But as soon as you connect this one, the second stage of amplification with a high input resistance, eventually the input signal that is connected over here, it will be no longer 240 times Vin. Rather, there will be coupling loss, and this coupling loss is given by, so now I can write, so this Vin2, which is the output voltage, input voltage of the second stage, so this will be now 240 times Vin1, 240 times Vin1, which is nothing but the output voltage over here under no load condition, open circuit condition. Now this is multiplied with the corresponding coupling loss over here. So what is the coupling loss? As you know already, this is nothing but R in 2 upon R in 2 plus R out 1. So here we have 22.5 kilo ohms upon 22.5 plus 3 kilo ohms. So this will be the coupling loss. So obviously our objective is to make this factor close to 1, very much close to 1, but as you know, it is not exactly equal to 1. Because in order to make it 1, this input resistance will be infinite, but which is normally true. So input resistance here, it is 22.5 kilo ohms, and the output resistance of the first stage is given by 3 kilo ohms. So as a matter of fact, 22.5 upon 25.5. So it will be like 90% or 0.9 if we just calculate. So already there will be coupling loss of 10% while you connect the output of this one to the input of the second stage. So eventually you'll find that this there is a corresponding loss. This loss is given by almost close to 0.9. That means 10% will be lost and 0.9 will be coupled to the input of the second stage. And then you can calculate the gain of the second stage. So as you know, the gain of the second stage, AV2 is essentially governed by modulus of this, because there will be a phase shift between the input to output. This is typically given by RC upon RE. So it will be like 3 kilo ohms, that means 3000 by 100. So it will be like 30 only. So this particular amplifier, the second stage, will provide a voltage gain of 30, and this amplifier will give a voltage gain of 240 in isolation. Remember, this particular stage, first stage of amplifier with the emitter resistance bypassed, it will provide a voltage gain of 240 in isolation, and this particular amplifier with no bypass capacitor will provide a voltage gain of 30 in isolation. Now, whenever you make any attempt to connect the first stage, the output of the first stage to the input of the second one, then you will find that the overall voltage gain is not equal to 240 multiplied with 30. Rather, there will be several coupling losses. So already I have calculated one such coupling losses, which is because of coupling the output of the second stage to the input of the first, output of the first stage to the input of the second stage. And that is given by, for our calculation, for typical value of RC, IC and RE, for typical value of those parameters, it is coming like 22.5 upon 25.5. So you can calculate this one. And accordingly, if I have a non-zero source resistance, then also you can calculate what is the value of the coupling loss over here while coupling the input signal to the input of the first stage. There will be another additional coupling losses at this particular end. And finally, if I have another resistance over here, the load resistance over here, apart from the output resistance RC, then we have a third stage of coupling factor. So accordingly, we can understand, we can appreciate that if I have a multi-stage kind of thing, then the overall gain is not equal to given by the product of the individual gain. Rather, there will be several coupling losses that we must take into our consideration. Now, with this brief introduction regarding the multi-stage small signal amplifiers, now let us move to the frequency response characteristics, which belong to the unit 4 of our syllabus. Now, already you know that there are several things by which we can basically characterize any amplifier. We have also mentioned this in the last class. One is the voltage gain parameter. Second one is the current gain parameter, which are quite obvious, which you want to magnify always, which you want to increase always for our application. And apart from that, we have the input resistance of an amplifier, which you want to magnify for the voltage amplification. And then you have also calculated the output resistance. Now, based on these four parameters, we have already made a comparative study in the last class between common emitter, common base, and common collector. Common emitter, common base, common collector. We have seen that for common emitter amplifier, the voltage gain is pretty large, moderately large. So as for common base amplifier, however, for common collector amplifier, the voltage gain is less than 1. As far as the current gain is concerned, you have seen that both common emitter and common collector, they will provide a significant current gain. However, common base amplifier will not provide any current gain. As far as the input resistance is concerned, you have seen that common emitter amplifier is having a moderate value of the input resistance as well as the output resistance. However, for the common base amplifier, the input resistance is pretty low and the output resistance is pretty large. And for common collector amplifier, you have seen that input resistance is very large and the output resistance is very small. Now, these are the summary which we have discussed in the last unit, last module of our course. Now, apart from that, there is another important parameter which we normally forget to mention, which is known as the bandwidth of any amplifier. So what do you mean by the bandwidth? First of all, you have to understand what is meant by the bandwidth of any amplifier and which parameters or which essential components ultimately control the bandwidth of any amplifier. Now, to understand the concept of bandwidth, let us once again observe the amplifier as a black box. And suppose here we have some output port and we have some input port over here for this two-port network. And we have one signal source connected. We have some signal source connected over here. Let it be some Vs given by A times sine of omega t, like this. Now, this particular signal source is having a Hertz frequency, F is equal to omega by 2 pi. Now, accordingly, you have a corresponding output voltage over here. So, this is nothing but AV times Vs. If the gain of this amplifier is given by AV, this is AV times Vs. Now, so far, we have assumed that the voltage gain is remaining constant, irrespective of the configuration which we considered. Let it be GM times RC or let it be RC by RE. So, depending upon the configuration, the value of the voltage gain, the absolute value of the voltage gain might change. But we have assumed that the for any particular configuration, the value of this voltage gain is remaining constant. That means if I have a situation like this where there is an emitter resistance, which is a bypassed one by means of bypass capacitor, then the voltage gain is given by GM times RC. And if I have an emitter resistance with no capacitor in shunt, with no bypass capacitor in shunt, then the voltage gain is remaining constant, like RC upon RE. But in our discussion, we have already seen that there is no effect of capacitor or inductance over here, which can basically control the gain parameter to some extent. Because, you know, the resistance in the analysis, we have drawn the small signal model involving only the resistances. And as you know, the resistance always follow the Ohm's law, R is equal to V upon I, or V is equal to R into I, that particular thing. So for any resistance, it is frequency insensitive. So whether it be, say, 100 kilohertz signal or let it be 1 megahertz signal, the resistance will always follow this particular rule, V is equal to R into I, as governed by Ohm's law. That means the resistance is not a frequency sensitive device. Whereas we have a capacitor, which is very much sensitive to the frequency of operation. So although we did not connect, we can connect some capacitor over here for our application. One is known as the coupling capacitor. Then second one is known as the bypass capacitor, which are connected externally to the amplifying devices. But apart from that, there are a few capacitances which are already there inside this bipolar junction transistor, because you know that a bipolar junction transistor is a three-terminal device having two PN junctions, one between the emitter and base, and the second between the collector and base. So we have a two PN junction. One is a base emitter junction, second one is a base collector junction. Now, essentially, these two junctions are the PN junctions, and as a matter of fact, there will be junction capacitance which are present, very much present inside the transistor itself. And while we change the frequency of this particular input signal, if I change the frequency from say 1 kilohertz to 10 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz to say 100 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz to say 1 megahertz, or even if we increase the value of this frequency, then you will see that these capacitances, these transistor internal capacitances and the externally connected capacitances like CC and CE, they will take pivotal role in controlling the bandwidth of the amplifier. So what do you mean by the bandwidth? So you'll see that depending upon the frequency of operation, the corresponding gain value will no longer be constant. Rather, you will be having a scenario when initially the gain value is very small, Now, as you increase the frequency of operation, you'll see that the gain value will be increasing. And at a particular point of time, you'll find that the gain value will be remaining constant. It will be constant throughout up to certain limit. And then once again, as the frequency increases, the corresponding gain value will be reduced. So if I just draw the gain versus frequency graph, initially you'll see that as you increase the frequency, the gain will increase like this. Then a point will come in the frequency domain, in the frequency point, when the gain is remaining constant. And so far we have restricted our discussion within this zone. And then as the frequency increases, once again, the gain value drops like this. So as long as our discussion is concerned, we have initially considered within this range of operation. That means whenever the gain is remaining flat, that means the gain is not a function of frequency. That means gain is remaining essentially constant. And from that, we can basically deduce the bandwidth of the amplifier. So this is given by these two points. One is known as the lower cutoff frequency, and second one is known as the higher cutoff frequency. So once again, there are different nomenclature. So you can have a 3 dB cutoff frequency. If I assume that this point is at 0 dB, so with respect to this one, if there is a 3 dB fall, so accordingly, we can mark the lower cutoff frequency and higher cutoff frequency on the frequency axis, and we can basically find out the bandwidth given by FH up minus FL. That means the difference between the higher cutoff frequency and the lower cutoff frequency. And remember that the behavior of the amplifier beyond these two points, FL and FH, is primarily due to the effect of the capacitances. So initially, to start with, let us try to understand the effect of the transistor internal capacitance in controlling the bandwidth of the amplifier. Let me go to the next slide. And to start with, let us first consider a scenario. Let us try to identify that we have a signal source like this. So I'm not considering the transistor internal characteristics or internal structure initially. Rather, I will start my discussion from a different angle, from a different perspective. Let us consider that I'm having a signal source like this. I'm having a signal source like this, which can generate, say, 1 volt peak to peak, a sinusoidal signal, for example. And suppose this is connected to some black box. This is connected to some black box. I do not know what is there inside the black box, and try to visualize the entire analysis from the perspective of the signal source. That means let us try to personify the signal source, meaning that suppose you are the signal source and you just feel what is happening or what is there inside the black box. Now suppose this signal source is generating one volt signal, peak to peak signal. Let it be a small signal, so it is also applicable for a constant supply of DC signal. So this end is connected to the ground, and this end of this small signal is connected to the input port of the amplifier or this black box itself. And suppose we find that there is a corresponding current of say 1 milliampere being drawn by this amplifier. So suppose you are the signal source. So let us try to personify the signal source. So I do not know what is there beyond this boundary. The signal source doesn't have any idea what is there beyond this boundary. Signal source is supplying 1 volt sinusoidal signal at this particular end, and it observes that this amplifier circuit or this black box is drawing a current equal to 1 milliampere. So from the signal source perspective, it might think that probably there is a resistance connected over here. There is a resistance connected over here whose one end is connected at this particular point and whose other end is essentially grounded with a value equal to 1 kilo ohms. Because if I have a 1 volt supply over here, and if the value of the resistance is equal to 1 kilo ohms, so then only the current being drawn by this black box will be 1 milliampere. But This is basically the perspective of the small signal source. Basically, we do not know what is there inside the black box. Even we do not know what is the potential at this particular point. Let us try to change the potential at this particular point. Suppose instead of making it grounded, let us consider that. Let me first write it down. So if it is grounded, then you will find that if the other end is grounded, then the current being drawn is 1 milliampere. Now suppose this end is not grounded, rather by some means this potential is kept at 500 millivolt. But the signal source is completely unaware of this situation. So it doesn't have any idea whether this potential is kept at 500 millivolt or no. Now suppose if by some means we can make this particular voltage at 500 millivolt, so the signal source is continuously supplying the same signal, that is 1 volt. So now the voltage drop will be only 500 millivolt. In that case, so eventually the resistance was 1 kilo ohms. Initially the resistance was 1 kilo ohms. Now, since it will be now 500 millivolt, so accordingly, the current being drawn will be less because the voltage drive is less now. So the current I will be 1 volt minus 0.5 volt upon 1 kilo ohms. So it will be like 0.5 milliampere. So under this condition, when the other end is connected to 0.5 volt, other end of the resistance, when it is connected to 0.5 volt, you have the same resistance of value equal to 1 kilo ohms. Physically, inside the amplifier, inside this black box, you have the same resistance of value of 1 kilo ohms. But if the other end of the resistance is not connected to ground, but if it is connected to some other potential of say 500 millivolt, that is 0.5 volt, then you'll see that obviously following the Ohm's law, the current through this resistance will be less. So now the current will become 0.5 milliampere instead of 1 milliampere. It will be now 0.5 milliampere. But this situation of making this particular potential at 0.5 volt is completely unknown to this signal source. Now, as a signal source, it will think that now I am supplying a signal of 1 millivolt, a 1 volt signal I am supplying, and now the current being drawn by the circuit itself is equal to 0.5 milliampere. So effectively, the signal source may think that the effective resistance connected between this terminal and the ground terminal, let it be 2 kilo ohms. So this is the understanding from the signal source perspective. Although actual resistance which is connected being the same, that is 1 kilo ohms. Similarly, instead of making 500 millivolt, now if I just change this potential and if I make this potential equal to, for example, 1 volt. If I make this potential equal to 1 volt, that means the same potential of the input signal. Now, if this potential is at 1 volt, then what happens? If this is 1 volt, we have the same signal, same resistance of 1 kilo ohms. Now, if this potential is kept at 1 volt, now, so 1 volt signal here, small signal, here also 1 volt. So what will be the drop? Drop will be 0. So if it is kept at 1 volt, then the current which is flowing through the resistance or the current being drawn by the black box itself, it will be 0 only, 0 milliampere. So under this condition, since the current is 0 milliampere, then from the perspective of the signal source, it may think that the resistance which was actually connected between one terminal over here and the other terminal at the ground, now the voltage source may think that the resistance has become infinite. So it might think that the resistance has become infinite, although we have a same 1 kilo ohms resistance connected. The fallacy is that we are basically changing the potential. Suppose this is the point X. Now we are basically changing the potential at the point X by some means. And this voltage, so this signal source is completely unaware of the situation that this potential is a controllable potential. Or rather, I can also say that this potential is a function of the input potential. But this situation is completely unknown to this particular signal source. So as a matter of fact, it is making some wrong assumption over here. Similarly, if this potential is kept at -1 volt, so in that case, if it is -1 volt, then the base drive, the drive will be more because there will be drop of 2 volt. Then the current for the 1 kilo ohms resistance, the current will become now 2 milliampere. So now, since the current is 2 milliampere, then the signal source will think that the effective resistance has been reduced because the current has been increased from 1 milliampere to 2 milliampere. So it might think that the resistance which was connected is only 500 ohms, because 2 milliampere is the current being drawn by the black box, and 1 volt is the supply. So this particular signal source is thinking that, okay, this potential is a ground potential, which is not the case. It is kept at -1 volt. So as a matter of fact, the effective resistance which is perceived by this signal source has been reduced to 500 ohms. So what is the bottom line? The bottom line is that whenever the other end of this resistance is not at a constant potential, rather if this potential can be made a function of the input signal source, then we find that the effective resistance as perceived by this signal source is also not constant. Whenever we have a gain of positive value, positive magnitude, suppose this value equal to, for example, if it is 1 volt and we have a 1 volt over here, so if I have a positive gain, so in that case the current will be zero and the resistance will be infinite, the effective resistance as perceived by the signal source. On the other hand, if I have a negative gain, 1 volt and -1 volt, if I have a negative gain over here, so in that case the current will be enhanced and the effective resistance will be reduced. So let us now try to generalize this thing. That means let us try to identify that this potential at this particular point, obviously it is controllable, and this value is a function of the input signal itself. By virtue of this, we are making this comment that there is a feedback between this particular point and the input. So let us try to identify the circuit like this. We have an amplifier as a black box. We have a signal source connected over here. This is the output side. Now the signal source is generating a voltage of say V1. This amplifier is having a gain of say A. So as a matter of fact, if this potential is V1, then obviously this potential output side, we have A times V1, which is equal to V2. Now suppose one end of the resistance or one end of this impedance. So now let us try to generalize our discussion. Instead of having a resistance, there could have been an impedance as well. So one end of this impedance is connected to the signal source, that is fine, and the other end is connected to the output port, so that this particular potential will eventually become the function of the input signal. Now let us try to identify that this particular impedance is given by Z. This is Z. Then try to understand what is the current being drawn by this particular impedance. So let this current be, let it be I1. So what will be I1? So I1 will be V1 minus V2 upon Z. So this is nothing but V1 minus V2 is A times V1. AV1 upon Z. So this is the actual expression for the current. Now from the signal source point of view, So this signal source is completely unaware whether this end is connected to the output end of this amplifier or not. Now, from the signal source perspective, the effective impedance as perceived by the signal source is given up by V1 upon I1, because it is feeding a signal of V1, and the current being drawn by these blocks is I1. So V1 upon I1. So if I just calculate from this expression, V1 by I1, it is coming like Z upon 1 minus A. So the effective impedance is equal to Z upon 1 minus A, where A is the gain of this particular amplifier. Now let us try to match whether this particular expression is valid for our previous discussion or not. Now here, for the second case, when it was connected to 0.5 volt potential, the input signal was same at 1 volt. The output signal, the potential at this point is at 0.5 volt. That means we can think that the gain value is equal to 0.5. The gain value equal to 0.5. And as a matter of fact, since the gain value is 0.5, so if I put 1 minus 0.5 over here, so the effective resistance will be 2 times of Z, so which was obtained as 2 kilo ohms. Similarly, if this potential is at 1 volt, so in which case the gain value is equal to 1. So if it is 1, if A is equal to 1, so in which case you will find that the effective impedance as perceived by the signal source is given by Z by 0, that is infinite. So this is also justified or validated from the previous analysis. And lastly, if this particular potential is kept at minus 1 volt, in which case the gain value is minus 1, so in which case you will see that the denominator becomes plus 2, 1 minus or minus 1, so plus 2. So the effective impedance provided by or as perceived by this particular signal source will be reduced, Z upon 2. So if actually the resistance was 1 kilo ohm, now it will become 1 kilo ohms upon 2, that means 500 ohms. So actually these two, this expression and this analysis, so these two discussions are in agreement. Now this is the expression for the effective impedance. Now you know for a capacitance, the reactance value is given by the inverse of the capacitance, x equal to 1 upon j omega c. Now you have seen that Z effective, which is the effective value impedance, is equal to Z upon 1 minus A. Z effective. Now since this Z or X, which is nothing but the reactance or the impedance, since it is inversely proportional to the value of the capacitance, so for the capacitance, the effective capacitance as perceived by the signal source from the input side itself, it will be magnified, it will be multiplied C into 1 minus A, just like this. Because this impedance and the capacitance, they are inversely proportional to each other. Now let us try to identify what was there in the small signal model of any amplifier, of any common emitter amplifier, for example. As you know, we have in the small signal model, we have this resistance R pi. This is the base terminal, this is the emitter terminal, and this R pi is connected over here. Now apart from that, we have this current source Gm times V pi, where V pi is this potential, and we have an R naught. Connected over here. Now, apart from these three elements, if I want to incorporate the different capacitance, as you know, So this is the collector terminal. This is the collector terminal over here. This is the collector terminal. Now, apart from these three elements, we can also introduce the capacitances, transistor internal capacitances. So one capacitor is connected between the base emitter junction. It is not an external capacitance, but its effect can be understood. So this capacitance is connected between this base emitter junction, or its effect can be identified. This is known as CBE, base to emitter capacitance, or sometimes it is also known as CE or CPI. Same nomenclature, CBE or CE or CPI. And the other capacitance, which is connected over here, is between the base and collector, which is the capacitor known as BC. Capacitance connected between the base and the collector. So which is equal to CC, or it is also known as C mu. So eventually you have two different capacitances which are not connected externally, but whose effect can be validated internally because of the presence of two p-n junctions inside the transistor, inside any bipolar junction transistor. One is the base emitter capacitance, which is connected in shunt with base and emitter junction, and the second one is the base collector junction, which is there between base and collector terminal. So first capacitor is known as the CE capacitance or CPI capacitance, and this capacitor is known as the CC capacitor or C mu capacitor. Now, from the signal source perspective, so there is no problem with this capacitance CPI because it is connected already between these two terminal. Now, what will be the effect for this capacitor at the input side? At the input side, effectively this capacitor, this CBC capacitor, eventually this capacitor is connected over here. CBC is connected between the base to collector, just like the thing which we have discussed so far. Now, from the signal source perspective, the effective capacitance because of this one, as perceived by the signal source, is given by CM, where CM is given by C mu times 1 minus A, where A is the gain of the amplifier. So while writing A, we have not considered whether it's a positive gain or negative gain. So if the gain expression is negative, then obviously it should be taken into account. It will become for any common emitter amplifier, as you know, the gain is normally given by minus gm times RC. So in which case, this CM will become C mu times 1 plus gm times RC. So this capacitor, the effective capacitance, looking between this base to emitter junction, it will be CM, that is equal to C mu into 1 minus A. So now, between the base and emitter, we have two capacitances connected in shunt. So the total capacitor over here will be equal to C pi plus C mu, since they are connected in the shunt path. C pi plus C mu. And this effect of converting the base collector capacitor, of having an equivalence between the CM and CBC by this particular formula, CM is equal to C mu times 1 minus A. This effect is known as the Miller effect, which you will find in many of the textbooks. And this capacitance CM is known as the Miller capacitance. So Miller capacitance CM is given by C mu times 1 minus A. And accordingly, the total capacitor CT is given by C pi plus C mu. Now, this capacitor CT will play some pivotal role in controlling the bandwidth of the amplifier. Similarly, at the output side, looking from this terminal, looking from this end, whenever we have this CBC, which is connected between the collector to base, the effective capacitance, looking from this terminal, the effect of this CBC or effect of this Miller cap or effect of this C mu capacitance at the output side will be given by A upon 1 minus A times C. So for high value of the gain, this is C means C mu. So for the high value of the gain, high value of the value of A, it will be close to C mu. So at the input side, we have a corresponding enlargement in the value of the capacitance because of this 1 minus A factor. However, in the output side, this value is remaining essentially constant at C mu. So we are also, this capacitor C mu is connected between base to collector, but remember that one terminal is the input terminal and the other terminal is the output terminal. So whenever we are trying to identify the effect of this C mu capacitance at the input side and the output side, we have to apply this Miller theorem separately. For the input side, we have seen that the effective capacitance looking at the input terminal is given by C mu times 1 minus A. And if we follow the same analysis, same calculation, you will find that the effect of this capacitor, C mu capacitor, at the output side between collector to ground is given by A upon 1 minus A times C mu. So for high value of the gain, this A and 1 minus A, they are very much close to each other. And we can already approximate this one by C mu only. Now this capacitance, this Cm, C pi and C mu over here, along with the other capacitances, that means the coupling capacitor and in some cases the bypass capacitors as well. So they will play some important role in controlling the bandwidth of any amplifier. And we will discuss the effect of this capacitor in much more detail in the next class.